I'm glad that you could join me today so you and I can go and tour these various highlight sites, because you know you want to be in the place where it happened, the sites where it happened, the rooms where it happened, the rooms where it happened. We're going to show you those rooms, so come along. Alexander Hamilton left St. Croix via Boston, stopped in New York for a moment, and ended up here to get his prep school in Elizabethtown, New Jersey. Alexander Hamilton left St. Croix in October and arrived here for classes in 1772 when he was 15 years old, not quite 16. When Alexander Hamilton lived in St. Croix, he met Reverend Hugh Knox, who gave letters of introduction to Reverend James Caldwell here at this church, the first Presbyterian. In fact, the Revolutionary War was often referred to by King George as that damn Presbyterian resistance. A number of the elders here and mentors to Alexander Hamilton were both Elias Boudinot and William Livingston, who attended this church, and really that thinking influenced Alexander Hamilton very early in his development, in getting his preparation and training. So he got his religious worship here at this church. Alexander Hamilton arrived on this spot in October of 1772. He was 15 years old. He had just come to the Caribbean. He was born on January 11, 1757. When he was 8.5 years old, his whole family moved to St. Croix for another 7 years. He had little or no formal training that we know of, so he came to the mainland to get an education. But to be able to go to one of the universities, he had to go through prep school. The site of the Academy of Elizabethtown prepared students to go to the College of New Jersey, which now we know as Princeton University. In fact, Aaron Burr attended here earlier than when Alexander Hamilton showed up. Alexander Hamilton was planning to go to the College of New Jersey or Princeton. He was accepted, but then when he made the request to move at his own accelerated pace, they turned him down, so Hamilton redirected to King's College in Lower Manhattan, and which is now known as Columbia University. Alexander Hamilton attended the Academy of Elizabethtown from October 1772 through the summer of 1773, when he then went on to King's College. This is an example of the important sites where Alexander Hamilton formed his future, ended up contributing, the people that influenced him here. New Jersey had a profound impact on Alexander Hamilton's life. He was taught here. He fought here. He had his vision for manufacturing in New Jersey, and he lost his life as a result of the duel that happened in New Jersey. New Jersey played a major role. And so I often say that Alexander Hamilton is a founding father from both New York and New Jersey. His mentors were the ones that gave him that early understanding of democracy and enlightenment thinker. Right here in Elizabethtown, over 350 years ago, this was where the English colony began in the whole state of New Jersey. So New Jersey started here in Elizabethtown, and Alexander Hamilton started in the mainland here, Elizabethtown, at the academy at Elizabethtown. We are in Elizabethtown, New Jersey, now as Elizabeth, New Jersey, and we're at Boxwood Hall, which was the home of Elias Boudinot and his family. During 1772 and 1773, when Alexander Hamilton was going to prep school to go to college, he often would visit and stay with the family in this actual house. When Alexander Hamilton served in Congress for New York State in 1782 and 1783, it was Elias Boudinot who was president of the Congress of the Confederation. So the influence of the mentoring of Elias Boudinot, in fact, Reverend Hugh Knox in St. Croix gave a letter specifically, a letter of introduction for Alexander Hamilton to meet Elias Boudinot. This is the actual home. These are the actual steps. So come and join me as we walk in as Alexander Hamilton would have walked into Boxwood Hall. We are in Morristown, New Jersey at the Morristown Green. You see these three bronze statues here, General Washington, General Marquis de Lafayette, and Lieutenant Colonel Alexander Hamilton. This depicts the scene in 1780 when Marquis de Lafayette shares the good news with General Washington that France is going to support with naval ships and boots on the ground and money to really fight against the British. So this is one of the happiest moments for General Washington. This green is the site of the first winter encampment that General Washington had in 1777, and later on during this period of 1780 for this communication, actually was at the second winter encampment, which is at the Ford Mansion about a mile from here. We're in Morristown, New Jersey at the first winter encampment site for General Washington. This was from January to May of 1777, just after the successes in Trenton, New Jersey and Princeton, New Jersey. It's at this location at Arnold Tavern is where Alexander Hamilton joined George Washington's staff as aide-de-camp. A beginning of a four-year relationship side by side with General George Washington. Not only was Hamilton a writing aide, he was a riding aide as he would go out to the officers with instructions from General Washington. What was really special about Alexander Hamilton at this point joining George Washington's family was that it began a 22-year relationship with George Washington, not only for the 4 years during the war, but also during the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia. Then two terms as president. And so this relationship that began here on March 1st, 1777, was instrumental not just to George Washington, but to our nation, because it was General Washington and President Washington who believed in Hamilton and gave Hamilton's very creative, sophisticated ideas and systems a chance to prove themselves. As George Washington stated, Alexander Hamilton was my principal and most confidential aide. While on General Washington's staff, Alexander Hamilton wrote over 50% of the instructions to the officers in the field. He was the principal communicator to Congress in Philadelphia. He was the principal communicator to the governors of the various states. He was the principal communicator to the generals and officers in the field. Alexander Hamilton played really the right-hand man responsibility to George Washington. And that's where this indispensable relationship began, right here, Arnold Tavern, March 1st, 1777. And this was just after Alexander Hamilton had showed his courage and bravery in the artillery from New York State and was respected from a number of generals, reported to George Washington. He observed. This is Morristown, New Jersey, the National Park site, Washington's headquarters. Encampment of 1779-1780 found George Washington here at the Ford Mansion. Alexander Hamilton were also here in this home. Alexander Hamilton was still aide-de-camp here, where he was often looked to by General Washington whenever some important communication would come into the general. He would always tap Washington on the shoulder to do the writing, either the governors, to Congress, to the officers in the field. Front entrance of what's known now as the Schuyler Hamilton House. Alexander Hamilton used to walk in these doors to court Elizabeth Schuyler, also known as Eliza, in the early winter of 1780, and by April of that year they had an understanding. In essence, they were engaged, and later in December 14th of 1780 they both got married up at her parents and her home up at the Schuyler Mansion in Albany, New York. This home was purchased by the National Society of the Daughters of the American Revolution in 1923, and they've lovingly restored it, cared for it, and shared it with the public. Here we are on the Hudson River, and you can see the manifestation of Hamilton's vision on both sides. Behind me, you see the city that he founded in New Jersey. You can see the results here in New Jersey behind me, in Jersey City, what that vision led to by founding the city, by acquiring the property, and sure enough, his vision did come to be. You can see evidence behind me in Jersey City, how it's become a leading city, and it continues to play a more important role. Jersey City started with a vision and a purchase of land, and now you see that it has become the major, largest city in the state of New Jersey. This is what's unique about Alexander Hamilton. He has a vision and it becomes real. He sees it before anybody else. It takes sometimes 100 years for the nation and the states to catch up with his vision. Here we are in Paterson, New Jersey, at the Passaic River, known as the Paterson Great Falls. Alexander Hamilton's first viewing of this falls was after the Battle of Monmouth in 1778. So here Hamilton was with McHenry, General Washington, General Marquis de Lafayette, and they had a picnic here in Paterson on July 10, 1778. Hamilton looked, he saw the power of the falls, and he said, "I can see the power of these falls driving factories and manufacturing." And Hamilton strongly felt that if he truly wanted to get independence, it wouldn't just be through fighting, but also freeing ourselves from the reliance and dependence on other nations for our manufactured goods. If we ever go to war with those countries, they would have all the foundries and the ammunition and the gunpowder and the cannons, etc., that we wouldn't be able to defend ourselves. So for true independence, he thought we should have an industrial manufacture. So actually, in 1791, create the Society for the Establishment of Useful Manufactures, November 1791, by the establishment of the city of Paterson and the manufacturing vision that Alexander Hamilton had, which he also documented in his report on manufacturers in 1791. July 11th, 1804, a day that saddens many of us Hamiltonians. Alexander Hamilton got in a rowboat, 7 a.m., to face Thomas Jefferson's vice president at the time, Aaron Burr. So we're at the bluffs overlooking the spot where the duel happened. So July 11th, 1804, when Alexander Hamilton was struck with a bullet from Vice President Aaron Burr, he was rowed across, back across the Hudson River to New York City, where he passed away 30 hours later, surrounded by friends and his family. At this spot, it brings great sadness to those who admire and appreciate what Alexander Hamilton did. But if you really want to see what he accomplished, the impact he had was for New Jersey and New York on both sides of the Hudson River, his contribution can be seen as we look across the skyline. As we look to the right, it's the financial district where Alexander Hamilton put in place the economic systems, the financial systems, the banking systems, the investment systems that allowed the nation to pay off its debt, strengthen its budget posture, fund the national government, and between both the government system and the economic system, developed a very powerful, successful nation. And so it was here that the end of Alexander Hamilton's life and contributions occurred. You see the image of the Empire State Builder. And to our right, you see the Empire State Building. The builder resulted from his vision for America, the building you see. Hello, we're at Hamilton Grange, the home of Alexander and Elizabeth Hamilton, also known as Eliza, and all of her 8 children grew up to adulthood here. The home was designed and architect by John McComb Jr., who designed this home, City Hall, Castle Clinton, and the Gracie Mansion. Eliza and Alexander lived here with eight children, all grew to adulthood. After Alexander Hamilton died from the wounds in the duel, Elizabeth lived in this home with her children for about another 30 years. Alexander Hamilton bought a number of parcels. One was about 32, 33 acres, and then he bought a smaller sliver, so maybe 35, 36 total acres. And what's interesting that although the home is in 3 different locations, it always has resided in the original property perimeter of those acreages. A very rural area. This is way out in the country. It's about 10 to 11 miles from Wall Street, Broadway. So this is the getaway place and a real special place to entertain. If the weather cooperated and the roads were in decent, passable condition, it would take about an hour and a half to get between downtown Manhattan and uptown Manhattan here. In October of 1772, Alexander Hamilton left St. Croix on a ship by way of Boston, and he came to New York City with letters of introduction. The Mulligans were the family that first received Alexander Hamilton in New York City, and his friend that he bonded with right away was Hercules Mulligan. And when Alexander Hamilton was attending King's College or about to attend King's College, he actually stayed with the Mulligan family here, 218 Pearl Street, just not far from Wall Street. Hercules Mulligan was a tailor here in Lower Manhattan, and at the time you'll remember that the British soldiers were here, and he would hear things when people would come in to get suits, if they needed more cloth, if they needed more, he would overhear this, that oh, there must be some initiatives that the British are going to take. That would be fed through from Hercules Mulligan and get to Alexander Hamilton, who would then provide that to General Washington. The understanding by many people in this area is that Hercules Mulligan was actually friends of the Loyalists, such that he was under suspicion. Therefore, General Washington, on evacuation day and thereafter, came to thank Hercules Mulligan specifically, and Rivington from the Rivington Press. Those two specifically, General Washington thanked for their part in helping with intelligence such that we could make better decisions and lead to victory and our independence as a nation. So Hercules Mulligan here, Hamilton stayed here, they had a relationship. Hamilton was able to rely on that for intelligence and spy information that helped contribute significantly to the success. Behind me on the southwest corner of Church Street and Park Place is where King's College was. Alexander Hamilton finished his prep school in the summer of 1773 and came here in the fall of 73, became formally matriculated in the spring of 74, and continued his classes until the spring of 76, when King's College had to suspend the teaching of the classes because it had to be used in support of the war effort. Interestingly, this is the famous story where Alexander Hamilton, even though he was on the Patriot side, defended the mob who came to get the president, Miles Cooper, and it was Hamilton who felt that we can have principled disagreement, but we should not be mobbish in our behavior. And that happened right here where he kept them at bay, where Miles Cooper was able to escape out the back. And here we are at the Commons, which today is at the site of City Hall and City Hall Fountain and Park. And Alexander Hamilton had just written two impactful pamphlets in defense of Congress's claims of what they were concerned about Britain's treatment of us. So the people were encouraging him to get in front of the crowd.
When
Alexander Hamilton was first here, there were pro and con conversations about staying with Britain or separating from Britain with independence. And Alexander Hamilton was encouraged to go and share his thoughts. And as he warmed up, he became very eloquent. And this is the earliest time that people really could see his oratory skills, the influence. And so then people continued to look to him more and more for a leadership role in the war and thereafter. George Washington received a copy of the Declaration of Independence, and it was read right here at the Commons on July 9, 1776. Alexander Hamilton was here when that was read. Hamilton was serving in the military in defense of Manhattan at the time. Here we are at St. Paul's Chapel in Lower Manhattan. It was built in 1766. A few blocks from here is where Alexander Hamilton went to college at King's College, which now eventually turned into Columbia University. But in 1775, April 19th in Concord and Lexington is when the war kicked off, and it looked like we all need to prepare as all the colonies for the Revolutionary War. So Alexander Hamilton got some people together and did drilling here, back and forth, and he started studying about military. So right here at St. Paul Chapel in this area is where he was drilling. And he was admired by people who observed the precision, the formation, the clothing dedication. And so from there, in March of 1776, he became the captain of the artillery for New York. He launched on to helping defend the rear guard, especially of the British chasing Washington's troops, such that he earned acclaim and recommendations to George Washington, where George Washington eventually asked him to be his right-hand man, chief of staff, as aide-de-camp throughout the war for 4 years. So it began his military experience here in the mainland, began right here at St. Paul's Chapel. Nice. We are at 48 Wall Street, where the Bank of New York building existed for many years. Now, this wasn't the original location when Alexander Hamilton founded the Bank of New York in 1784. What was also unique about what Hamilton did is the bank was formed to remain more liquid. The assets could be convertible very quickly, so there was only a small percentage allowed to be in land. In 1784, when Alexander Hamilton founded the Bank of New York, it was the only bank in New York. So it set a precedent. And another very important thing about the Bank of New York is that when Alexander Hamilton was Secretary of Treasury in 1789, the first place he went was to get a loan from the Bank of New York such that it could help fund the federal government. And it was the first debt paid back under the Washington administration with Hamilton as Secretary of Treasury. So the Bank of New York has played a very important role right from the beginning. The first corporate stock that was listed on the New York Stock Exchange was the Bank of New York. And Alexander Hamilton understood that for an economy to have energy, it had to have capital. Money had to be put to work. So the function of the bank was to reward people for taking money that was sitting dormant, putting it to work and leverage and being loaned out to grow the nation. Interesting, 1784, remember that the Treaty of Paris was September of 83, then we had to rebuild New York's city, and the loyalists that Alexander Hamilton defended allowed the money to remain here in New York City, such that 1 year later, in 1785, the capital of the United States came to Federal Hall. It was in City Hall at the time. And so that was 3 years under the Congress of the Confederation, and then an additional 2 years under the U.S. Constitution. Alexander Hamilton knew that for a country to become vital, they needed entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs needed capital to be able to take their ideas. So Alexander Hamilton was a visionary, and he knew this was required to create the energy. And this burned out city in 1783 into 84 was rebuilt with the capital. So that's where Alexander Hamilton's vision turned into foundations, which then was the fuel for entrepreneurs. Behind me is the New York Stock Exchange. What many people don't realize is what was it that Alexander Hamilton did that created the need for the New York Stock Exchange. What happened was we were $77 million in debt as a nation, $52 million of it the national government owed to countries overseas and to the states of the nation. On top of that, the states owed $25 million back to the people who loaned the money to help fight the Revolutionary War. So here we have $77 million in debt. Hamilton was able to turn that debt into bonds. Those bonds became securities, and those securities then needed to be traded. People wanted to trade them for other things. They wanted to trade them and use them as leverage for borrowing money for businesses and for entrepreneurs. So that developed the need for the New York Stock Exchange, the need was created to be able to exchange these securities, which led a number of stock traders to get together to establish common commissions, common approaches, and discipline for this plethora of securities to be traded. So this occurred under the Buttonwood Tree here locally, where they agreed, and that turned into what now is the New York Stock Exchange. Behind me, we're at 57 Wall Street. Alexander Hamilton in the 1780s came here to live with Elizabeth at 57, 58 Wall Street. Alexander Hamilton was living at 57 Wall Street when he was selected as a Secretary of Treasury. The first 2 years of the capital of the United States, many people don't know this, actually under the Constitution, was here in New York City at Federal Hall, just down the street a block. On September 11th, 1789, President George Washington nominated Alexander Hamilton for Secretary of Treasury. That same day, Congress confirmed his position, and then Alexander Hamilton was underway immediately, right here at Federal Hall in New York City. When the capital of the United States was here in New York City, it was housed here at Federal Hall. The Senate, the House of Representatives resided here. We're on Broadway, just south of Trinity Church on Wall Street. On September 11, 1789, Alexander Hamilton became Secretary of Treasury. That was on a Friday. By Sunday, 2 days later, He was already in his office here. We don't know the exact area, but we do know it was on Broadway, south of Trinity and Wall Street. This is where he launched his reports on credit, et cetera, that really led the way to reshape our nation from poverty to prosperity. President Washington's second residence was right behind us here, where he resided and where Alexander Hamilton would have come to discuss urgent issues. Also visiting here would have been Secretary of State Thomas Jefferson. And Thomas Jefferson states that at one point in time he saw that Washington was struggling with how to get the assumption of state debt passed, and that led to the recollection of Jefferson with a negotiation to trade the capital of the United States, which was in New York City the first 2 years under the Constitution. Then it moved to Philadelphia for 10 years, and then on to Washington, D.C. So this is where Jefferson says they connected, saw the need, and Jefferson helped facilitate. We are at 57 Maiden Lane in Lower Manhattan. This was a home that was rented by then Secretary of State Thomas Jefferson. There were a number of debates going on in Congress just a couple of blocks from here on Wall Street, where the Capitol of the United States was at Federal Hall, about Alexander Hamilton's funding plans. And it passed the Senate, but it was stuck in the House, where Madison was not in support of Hamilton's idea of assuming the state's debts. Jefferson made a record of his version of what occurred here at his home, where he had a dinner, included both Madison and Hamilton, where the discussion was made from Jefferson's viewpoint that the Capitol would move from New York State, ending up in Washington, D.C., with a stop for 10 years in Philadelphia, with the understanding that Madison and the other Virginians would acquiesce and allow the state assumption, which Hamilton always said, this is critical to the success of my overall spending plan, is to deal, repackage all the debt, national and state debt, spread it out over many years, decrease it from 12% to 14% down to 3% and 6% bonds. So this is, in the musical, is known as I wanna be in the room where it happened, the room where it happened, the room where it happened. This was the room that's depicted in the Hamilton musical, 57 Maiden Lane. Many people read about documents that captured what happened in Congress. What many people don't realize is that really the strategy and the discussions about really what was going to be then executed in Congress or in the executive branch actually occurred in inns and taverns. One of the most instrumental ones is Francis Tavern here. This is where many of the leaders would come and plan their strategies that would unfold in subsequent sessions. Francis Tavern was actually a very common location for Alexander Hamilton and Hercules Mulligan, John Lord. They all would come here. It was their favorite. We're on Cedar Street. Cedar Street was the last work law office of Alexander Hamilton. It was here on Cedar where he wrote his last instructions before he headed out for the duel with Aaron Burr. We are at 25 Park Place. This was the home of John Barker Church and his wife Angelica Schuyler Church. This is Angelica's place. And upon the sad news and their attendance at Alexander Hamilton's bedside, Alexander Hamilton died at 2 p.m. on July 12th, 30 hours after he was shot at Weehawken in a duel with Vice President Aaron Burr. The body was taken from Bayard's house near Jane Street, where there's a plaque today, and was brought here for his body to be prepared for the 2 days. From this spot, Alexander Hamilton's body in a casket was carried in the path that led down to Trinity Church for the service and for the burial on July 14th, 1804. The eulogy was given by Gouverneur Morris. Behind us is Trinity Church at the corner of Broadway and Wall Street. This is where Hamilton, both Alexander Hamilton and Elizabeth, worshiped along with their children. Five of the eight children, we've seen the certificates, baptism certificates here. And they owned a pew. Alexander Hamilton served as a lawyer for the church. In fact, one of the real landmark cases in support of Trinity Church is the fact in the charter it was limited to a revenue of $5,000 a year, and he was able to understand and communicate to the church that they were free to have the full ownership of all the assets of the church. The result of that review was significant, because Trinity Church has gone on to be a landlord and rentals for the property that served the church and its congregants very well for a couple of hundred years. Behind me you see Alexander Hamilton's grave monument. This is where, when people want to be where Hamilton is, this is where people come in Lower Manhattan. The funeral parade occurred on July 14th from Angelica Church's home, and it made its way here for the ceremony, headed up by the Society of Cincinnati, many other groups throughout. They said it was the biggest attendance and lined the streets with people that they had ever seen up to that point. Person resting next to Alexander Hamilton now is Elizabeth Hamilton. In the cemetery somewhere, they don't know exactly where, is their firstborn son, Philip, who was also killed in a duel with the same guns in Weehawken, and he rests there as well. Angelica has a presence on the north side of the church. That Alexander Hamilton was born on January 11, 1757, he was thus 47 years old when he died in 1804. Behind me, if we zoomed in, you will see that it states that he died at age 47 years old.
In this tour of New York and New Jersey with Rand Cholet, we did not visit all the many places associated with Alexander Hamilton. There are many more, and they range across the entire America of his time, and so many where he had tremendous impact. We visited the important sites in the two states, New York and New Jersey, in which Alexander Hamilton spent more time during his life and had his greatest achievements. Rand Cholet has documented here the singular qualities of Hamilton that made him unique in all of American history. We would not be America were it not for Alexander Hamilton.